Penguin Audio presents Changing My Mind by Zadie Smith. Read by Barbara Rosenblat. In memory of my father. The time to make your mind up about people is never. Tracy Lord, The Philadelphia Story. You get to decide what to worship. David Foster Wallace. Foreword. This book was written without my knowledge. That is, I didn't realize I'd written it until someone pointed it out to me. I had thought I was writing a novel. Then, a solemn theoretical book about writing. Fail better. The deadlines for these came and went. In the meantime, I replied to the requests that came in now and then. 2,000 words about Christmas, about Katherine Hepburn, Kafka, Liberia. 100,000 words piled up that way. These are occasional essays in that they were written for particular occasions, particular editors. I'm especially grateful to Bob Silvers, David Remnick, Deborah Treisman, Cressida Lachon, Lisa Allardyce, and Sarah Sands for suggesting I stray into film reviewing, obituaries, cub reporting, literary criticism, and memoir. Without whom this book would not have been written. In this case, the cliché is empirically true. When you are first published at a young age, your writing grows with you, and in public. Changing My Mind seemed an apt, confessional title to describe this process. Reading through these pieces, though, I'm forced to recognize that ideological inconsistency is, for me, practically an article of faith. As is a cautious, optimistic creed best expressed by Saul Bellow. There may be truths on the side of life. I keep on waiting, but I don't think I'm going to grow out of it. Zadie Smith, New York, 2009. Part 1. Reading. Chapter 1. Their eyes were watching God. What does soulful mean? When I was 14, I was given Their Eyes Were Watching God by my mother. I was reluctant to read it. I knew what she meant by giving it to me, and I resented the inference. In the same spirit, she had introduced me to Wide Sargasso Sea and The Bluest Eye, and I had not liked either of them. Better to say, I had not allowed myself to like either of them. I preferred my own freely chosen heterogeneous reading list. I flattered myself I ranged widely in my reading, never choosing books for genetic or sociocultural reasons. Spotting Their Eyes Were Watching God unopened on my bedside table, my mother persisted. But you'll like it. Why, because she's black? No, because it's really good writing. I had my own ideas of good writing. It was a category that did not include aphoristic or overtly lyrical language, mythic imagery, accurately rendered folk speech, or the love tribulations of women. My literary defenses were up in preparation for Their Eyes Were Watching God. Then I read the first page. Ships at a distance have every man's wish on board. For some they come in with the tide. For others they sail forever on the horizon, never out of sight, never landing until the watcher turns his eyes away in resignation. His dreams mocked to death by time. That is the life of men. Now women forget all those things they don't want to remember, and remember everything they don't want to forget. The dream is the truth. Then they act and do things accordingly. It was an aphorism, yet it had me pinned to the ground, unable to deny its strength. It capitalized time. I was against the capitalization of abstract nouns, but still I found myself melancholy for these nameless men and their inevitable losses. The second part about women struck home. It remains as accurate a description of my mother and me as I have ever read. Then they act and do things accordingly. Well, all right then. I relaxed in my chair a little and laid down my pencil. I inhaled that book. 3 hours later I was finished and crying a lot. For reasons that both were and were not to do with the tragic finale. I lost many literary battles the day I read Their Eyes Were Watching God. I had to concede that occasionally aphorisms have their power. I had to give up the idea that Keats had a monopoly on the lyrical. She was stretched on her back beneath the pear tree, soaking in the alto chant of the visiting bees, the gold of the sun and the panting breath of the breeze when the inaudible voice of it all came to her. She saw a dust-nearing bee sink into the sanctum of a bloom, the thousand sister calyxes arch to meet the love embrace, and the ecstatic shiver of the tree from root to tiniest branch, creaming in every blossom and frothing with delight. So this was a marriage. She had been summoned to behold a revelation. Then Janie felt a pain, remorseless sweet, that left her limp and languid. But I still resist limp and languid. I had to admit, that mythic language is startling when it's good. Death, that strange being with the huge square toes who lived way in the west. The great one who lived in the straight house, like a platform without sides to it and without a roof. What need has death for a cover, and what winds can blow against him? My resistance to dialogue, encouraged by Nabokov, whom I idolized, struggled and then tumbled before Hurston's ear for black colloquial speech. In the mouths of unlettered people, she finds the bliss of quotidian metaphor. If God don't think no more about him than I do, they's a lost ball in the high grass. Of wisdom lightly worn, to my thinking, mourning oughtn't to last no longer in grief. Her conversations reveal individual personalities, accurately, swiftly, as if they had no author at all.
Where y'all come from in such a big haste?
Lee Coker asked.
Middle Georgie, Starks answered briskly. Joe Starks is my name, from in and through Georgie. You and your daughter going to join with us in fellowship?
The other reclining figure asked.
Mighty glad to have you. Hicks is the name. Governor Amos Hicks from Buford, South Carolina. Free, single, disengaged.
My God, I ain't nowhere near old enough to have no grown daughter. This here's my wife.
Hicks sank back and lost interest at once.
Where's the mayor? Starks persisted. I wants to talk with him. Yous are my two previous for that,
Coker told him.
Us ain't got none yet.
Above all, I had to let go of my objection to the love tribulations of women. The story of Janie's progress through three marriages confronts the reader with the significant idea that the choice one makes between partners, between one man and another, or one woman and another, stretches beyond romance. It is, in the end, the choice between values, possibilities, futures, hopes, arguments, shared concepts that fit the world as you experience it, languages, shared words that fit the world as you believe it to be, and lives. A world you share with Logan Killix is evidently not the same world you would share with Virgil Tea Cake Woods. In these two discrete worlds, you will not even think the same way. A mind trapped with Logan is freed with Tea Cake. But who in this context dare speak of freedoms? In practical terms, a black woman in turn-of-the-century America, a woman like Janie, or like Hurston herself, had approximately the same civil liberties as a farm animal.
The nigger woman is the mule of the world.
So goes Janie's grandmother's famous line. It hurt my pride to read it. It hurts Janie, too. She rejects the realpolitik of her grandmother, embarking on an existential revenge that is of the imagination and impossible to restrict. She knew that God tore down the old world every evening and built a new one by sunup. It was wonderful to see it take form with the sun and emerge from the grey dust of its making. The familiar people and things had failed her, so she hung over the gate and looked up the road towards way off. That part of Janie that is looking for someone or something
that spoke for far horizon, has its proud ancestors in Elizabeth Bennet, in Dorothea Brooke, in Jane Eyre, even, in a very debased form, in Emma Bovary. Since the beginning of fiction concerning the love tribulations of women, which is to say, since the beginning of fiction, the romantic quest aspect of these fictions has been too often casually ridiculed. Not long ago, I sat down to dinner with an American woman who told me how disappointed she'd been to finally read Middlemarch and find that it was just this long, whiny, trawling search for a man. Those who read Middlemarch in that way will find little in Their Eyes Were Watching God to please them. It's about a girl who takes some time to find the man she really loves. It is about the discovery of self in and through another. It implies that even the dark and terrible banality of racism can recede to a vanishing point when you understand and are understood by another human being. God damn it if it doesn't claim that love sets you free. These days, self-actualization is the aim, and if you can't do it alone, you are admitting a weakness. The potential rapture of human relationships to which Hurston gives unabashed expression, the profound, self-crushing love that Janie feels for Tea Cake, may, I suppose, look like the dull finale of a long, whiny, trawling search for a man. For Tea Cake and Janie, though, the choice of each other is experienced not as desperation, but as discovery, and the need felt on both sides causes them joy, not shame. That Tea Cake would not be our choice, that we disapprove of him often and despair of him occasionally, only lends power to the portrait. He seems to act with freedom, and Janie to choose him freely. We have no power, we only watch. Despite the novel's fairy tale structure, as far as husbands go, third time's the charm, it is not a novel of wish fulfillment. Least of all, the fulfillment of our wishes. Again, Middlemarch is an interesting comparison. Readers often prefer Lydgate and are disappointed at Dorothea's choice of Ladislaw. It is odd to diagnose weakness where lovers themselves do not feel it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.